Hello, I'm Michael Slohr, head of R&D here at ResResult. And in this video, we want to go into the details of how to use our new Trackbox passive. So the first thing that you need to know is how to set it up. There are several options. One is to put it on the ground like this. And the other one is to hang it of a lamppost or street sign like this with the integrated magnets. And the question is, what should you normally do? Actually, I would, if you can, always put it up somewhere, because what you want to do is you want to get over the heads of your spectators. So whenever you assume that somebody could be standing in front of the box, you should put it up high enough so that if the box is up there, it can look above the heads of your spectators, because UHF does not travel through the human body. If you, for example, have a trail run or a small event where you don't expect any spectators, you can just put it on the ground like this. As long as there's no one standing there, you won't have a problem. So if you set it up, what you obviously need to do is you need to turn it on. So on the back, there is a button, and you press that button. And if you press the button, the box will beep, and you will have two LEDs indicating what's going on. One is a red and green LED, and the other one is blue. The red and green LED works the same way as on our active track boxes. For the blinking patterns, please go to our knowledge base. There is an article about it, which gives you the explanations of what different blinking patterns mean. One thing that is important if you set it up is that every time you turn on a box, the first thing that the box will do is it will check whether there is a new firmware for it or not. And if there is a new firmware, it will automatically update itself. You can't stop that. So it's important to calculate into your setup time 1 to 2 minutes for firmware update should there be a new firmware. We will not do that very often, but especially now in the beginning, you should always expect that there could be a new firmware if you turn on the box. So always assume that it will take 1 to 2 minutes for the firmware update for the box to be ready. So what you will be waiting for is the red and green LED to blink green, meaning that it has GPS and it has not network coverage. Now here, as we are inside this building, most likely we will not get GPS, so it most likely will not start blinking green. But outside, that's what you're waiting for. That's what you're looking for. That's what you should tell your helpers. Turn it on, set it up, wait for the LED to blink green. The other LED, the blue LED, indicates whether the reader is operating or not. And it is very important to understand that when the blue LED is off, the reader is not reading. When the blue LED is on, the reader is reading. If the blue LED is flickering, the reader is actually seeing chips in range. So you can see whether the reader is picking up a chip by looking at the blue LED. If it flickers, it sees a chip. Now there are several reasons why the blue LED could be off. One obviously is if you remotely set the box to standby to save energy, then the blue LED would be off. A second possibility is that the battery is very low. If the battery is very low, the box will still be operating. You will still be able to communicate with it. You will still see it in the timing module, but the reader won't operate anymore. That's only at 0% battery if indicated in the timing module. The third way of shutting off the reader is by putting it on the ground like this, or on a table. So the orientation of the box now tells the box to go into standby. If you put it flat on the table like this, it goes into standby. And this is especially important for charging it overnight, because the box will always turn on when you apply power to it. So you want that for permanent installations and solar powered installations, we'll come to that later, that the box will always by itself power on as soon as it sees external power. So if you charge it, it is always on, But you don't want the reader to be reading all night long, because if you, for example, in your hotel room have other tags, you might end up using a lot of data on your SIM card, reading tags that you don't need overnight. And the charging performance is slower when the reader is on. So when the reader is in standby, blue LED off, it takes about 6 hours to charge the internal battery from 0 to 100%. If the reader is on, it takes about 10 hours to charge the internal battery from 0 to full. Now for charging, the kit of two boxes comes with this charging adapter. The connector on the box is a standard DC connector as we have it on our loop boxes and other active equipment. And the set comes with a standard 12 volt power supply. You can directly connect this to the box like this and screw it on there so that you don't lose it if you hang the box up somewhere. But for charging in your hotel room overnight, you can also use this adapter where you can charge two boxes at a time. So you can plug this in like this, and now both boxes will be charged by one adapter. So as said, all the blinking patterns are described in our knowledge base article, but there's one that you should be looking for especially. This is a red and green blinking pattern. So I will try to demonstrate this here now. Now you see that the box is blinking red and green. And this is because my hand in front of the antenna is reflecting a lot of RF energy, and the box is not able to compensate for that. So if you see the LED blinking, flashing red and green, then you should look at your setup and check whether there is something around the antenna interfering with the antenna, especially in front of the antenna. So the basic idea here is that this is a warning. The box will still operate, but it won't be the best performance you can get. So if whenever the box blinks red and green, try to adjust your antenna, try to see whether there's something in front of the antenna, or maybe even besides the antenna, could be somewhere here. Now here close to the antenna, same thing. Make sure there is optimum lots of space around the antenna. So now for setting it up, another question is whether you should be pointing the antenna to the participants coming to the box or not. So in our tests, we found that the optimum position actually is to have it perpendicular 90 degrees to the road. So if somebody comes by, the distance between the chip and the antenna at the antenna direction maximum gain is the shortest. If you point the box downwards to the participant, the distance between the transponder and the antenna at the point of the highest gain of the antenna will be larger. So it might be a little bit counterintuitive, but we found that putting them up perpendicular to the road 90 degrees gives you the best performance. The other thing is that it's more robust against strange things happening. For example, on one of our test events, we were told that participants would be coming from that direction, and then they came from that direction, and we didn't anticipate that. So just put them up 90 degrees to your track and you will be fine. Now, another very important question is, how do you configure this box? How do you set it up? Especially when you get the box brand new. I mean, there is no user interface. There's only one button. There's nothing you can do with the box. So one way to do it is using a management box and a tag tool like you are used to from our active track boxes. But we know that many of our passive system customers don't have any active system and don't have a management box. So there are other ways to do this. And the main way is to use a website you can find on racesout.com/setup, where you type in the box number and the setting that you want to change, and you press OK there, and then you have to press the button on the box 3 times quickly. So I will just demonstrate that now. I will press the button 3 times. It will then beep to indicate that it understood that you wanted to configure. And it will now ask the server, hey, do you have a new configuration for me? And that will be applied. That way we can make sure that you have physical access to the box. So nobody can change settings from a box that he doesn't own, and make it as simple as possible for you. So just check out raceresult.com/setup to set up your boxes. And you should be able to set everything up that you need there. It can be a little bit tricky using your own SIM cards, especially with SIM pins. Please contact us if you want to do anything there. The other way of setting them up is within RaceResult 12 or your software, you can set configuration rules to apply different settings to the box while they're on an event. So for example, one setting that you may want to change is the auto standby feature. There is an auto standby where you can set the box to standby overnight. You can tell it to be in standby between, let's say, 8 o'clock in the evening and 8 o'clock in the morning, saving lots of energy. And that is important if you want to use it with solar cells. For the solar cell mode, we actually have this 30 watt solar panel that we tested a lot with, which is enough on a normal German summer day to power this box as long as the sun is shining. The nice thing about this is that you can directly connect the box to the solar panel. You don't need any additional electronics. Actually, the charging circuit inside the box automatically detects that it's connected to a solar panel and will then do a maximum power point tracking, which is needed for solar panel operation, to draw as much power from the solar panel as possible. And in our tests so far, we found that a 30 watt panel like this is sufficient on almost any weather in a typical German summer. If you need more, then you may connect a bigger solar panel. We have 2 solar panels in our knowledge base that we can recommend. But every 12 volt solar panel should work. So obviously with auto standby and solar panels, this is also meant to be used for permanent or semi-permanent installations. So this box can be set up at remote locations with a solar panel and run basically for weeks or months. And as you can set it up somewhere high, it can be safe against vandalism and enabling a new type of events that were not really thinkable before. So if you are used to our passive system, you may sometimes look at the details of the detections with hits and RSSI values. And if you want to check how well everything is going, a rule of thumb with this box is that a typical passing will have around 20 hits. Okay, this is for normal running speed or cycling speed. And what you should know is that the antenna opening angle is about 45 degrees to each side. So there is a 90 degrees opening angle here. And if you have higher speeds, it may make sense to have a little bit more distance between the box and your participant. We just tested last weekend on a road race cycling event where they were going 60 kilometers per hour. And there at about 1 to 2 meter distance, we had around 10 hits. You can expect to get about 99% detection rate within 4 meters of range. If you need more, you will need 2 boxes. For that, it's important that there is interference between the box and a floor antenna, but there's also interference between 2 boxes. But the two boxes, when you set them up on both sides of the street, will communicate with each other and will automatically synchronize so that they do not interfere. So for having more than 4 meters wide road, you would want to have two boxes on both sides. They will automatically synchronize, but you don't want to put the box near a normal timing system anywhere, because then you will have lots of interference degrading both the timing system performance and also the track box performance. So this box is meant to be used for splits and checkpoints. So it is meant to be used at locations where you don't have a high density of participants. It is not meant to be used at a start or finish line, or even if you have a large 5K race, maybe at a first split after 1K, because the UHF RF energy does not travel through the human body. So if two participants are running close to each other, you will not see the one which is in the shade of the first participant. And this is important to understand. And therefore, this box will not replace timing systems. It is a good addition to existing timing systems. It will enable new splits and checkpoints at locations where at the moment you either you can't afford or you don't want to put someone with a timing system. And now you can just go there, put that on a lamppost, and that's it. So make sure to understand that you will not replace a timing system at the start and finish line with this box. It is meant for splits. That's it for now for details of how to use the box. To be honest, we still have to figure out many things ourselves because it's a brand new product. I guess there will be more videos about this product once we know how to use it ourselves. And for now, please also always refer to the knowledge base articles about it. We will continuously update the information there and make sure that everything that you need to know to operate the Trackbox Passive is in our knowledge base. So it's always recommended to have a look in the knowledge base. Actually, our team here is taking great pride in what they do in the knowledge base to have a lot of information at your hand whenever you need it, so that you can just read how to use our equipment and how to do things. And this is especially true for this new product. So I hope you like the passive Trackbox, and there will be another video about the technical details of the Trackbox, and stay tuned for that.